Good morning, Ebenezer Baptist Church. Welcome to our Sunday morning service on this blisteringly hot day. You do realise when we leave the building it's going to be 26 degrees. So you're going to have to run to the car, open all the car doors and stand back for 5 minutes. Let the car cool down. Let's begin with a word of prayer. John, Bible John.
Yes.
You're my bookend. Would you open us in the word of prayer, please?
Once again, Heavenly Father, come before you. In recognition, Heavenly Father, of our blessing this day, Heavenly Father, you've got some sunshine out for this week, Heavenly Father. And it makes the world a brighter place, Heavenly Father. And it's not just the physical side of the sun, Heavenly Father. We thank you once again for the blessing of your Son, Jesus. Thank you for giving us a realization, Heavenly Father, the reason why you came, Heavenly Father. Not for the pleasure of the world, but for the soul of the world. We thank you for your word in the book, Heavenly Father, the holy book, the Bible. Thank you for the plaster, Heavenly Father, with the gift that you have given him, Heavenly Father, of interpreting it. Give us ears to hear, Lord, so we can take it with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. This morning's Bible reading is from John chapter 3. John chapter 3, verses 22, all the way down to verse 30. And there it says, after these things came Jesus and his disciples into the land of Judea, and there he tarried with them and baptized. And John also was baptizing in Aenon near Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. For John was not yet cast into prison. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. Ye yourselves bear witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom which standeth and heareth him rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This my joy, therefore, is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must increase. May God bless the reading of his word. And today we have something very special. We have the children from Sunday school are going to sing for us all the songs except the last one. Are you ready, Suze? Yeah?
Children are going to sing this week. I'm going to sing some of our choruses. We hope
technology
works. If it doesn't, we'll just muddle through. The older ones are helping us out, even though some of the songs are for the younger ones, really. Can you join us?
Our God is a great big God.
It was put on hold by time, by Kareem's being built. But it declares Henry Henry of the Burger of his house, he devotes his mission to the
Just click on the big minimise button at the top there. Next one. No, that one. There we go. Fantastic. Technology is grand, isn't it? Let me put this back down. Okay, we have a few notices. Don't forget our Wednesday night Bible study, 7 o'clock. 7:30 even, be here for that, because as I always say, prayer is the powerhouse of the church. And then on Thursday we have our little angels, and we have a few little angels that have grown up into big angels. What time is that at, Sue? 10:30? Sue Lavelle? Little angels? At 10, okay. Then we have Crafty Women on Friday, which is about that time as well. 11, okay. So don't forget those like I did. And also we have another important piece of information, because tomorrow the restrictions end, which we're all really pleased about, but with caution. Okay? Now there's a number of things with the myself and some of the committee members have talked about how this church can go through this and start reopening things if everything goes to plan. because we know what it's been like the last year. Things have been a little bit up and down. So we're allowed to sing. So on Wednesday, we're going to start singing a hymn before and after the service. That's something everybody would like to do. So we're going to try that out. And next Sunday, you can stand up and sing at the top of your voice, wearing your face mask, not wearing your face mask. You can sit next to somebody or not sit next to somebody. Okay? And if you go to sit next to somebody who says, excuse me, I'd just like to remain socially distanced, don't take offence. That's fine. Just go and sit next a little bit further away from them and you can carry on talking. Just make sure, just be aware of everybody's preference, okay? We're not going to have fellowship next door just yet. And the main reason for that is because that's an uncontrollable situation. We can't control where everybody's going to be. Everyone's going to get tea and they're going to move around and chat. So that's a little bit too much at this time, okay? And everything else is going to stay the same. And I believe that we're going to have a ladies' meeting. Yeah, planning on a ladies' meeting, because again, that can be controlled and kept in place. Birthdays. Sue Naylor, come and see if we've got any birthdays.
We have, it's Mr. Lavelle. Woo, Alan! Mr. Lavelle's birthday on Saturday.
Oh, the bouncer.
And Shay, is no? Oh, well, we did sing. Yeah, we did get you last week, Alex, on the screen. And Shay, when's your birthday? Is your birthday? Pardon? Oh, we'll get you next Sunday, all right? Yeah, okay then. So happy birthday, we're going to sing to you as well, Alex. And Mr. Lavelle.
Mr. Lavelle, you've got to come in here.
Just in case you don't know him. Lucy's going to be bouncer. Yeah. Just practicing for next week, because they're making... What? I've been asked to ask how old you are. I know, but I won't tell them.
I know how long I've been married.
That's tomorrow. Yeah, and happy anniversary to Sue and Alan tomorrow, because it's their wedding anniversary tomorrow.
How did you make it, Sue?
Not there yet. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. May you feel Jesus near every day of the year. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. And the best one that you ever had.
Yes, give Alan some presents, because he's the only one that keeps this building up sometimes, I think. Okay, we have some more songs. Yeah, and we already started.
Right, we'll go for that one.
I next to the day. Keep going down.
Watching over you.
Well, that was fantastic, especially for something we'd just arranged 5 minutes before church. But weren't the kids amazing? They got up here and they sang and they really, really enjoyed themselves. I thought that was brilliant. And you're not getting those actions from me, by the way. I'm not doing that. Not when I sing. Let's look at our Bible reading today. We're in John chapter 3. And we've gone all the way from John chapter 1, where we saw God was in the beginning. And we've seen Jesus talking to Nicodemus in this chapter. And now we're seeing John explaining something to his disciples who've raised a question to him. In John chapter 3, I'll read it again. We won't have any words up on the screen because our technician is in there with the teens or has gone. The other one is not here, so we'll have to do it the old-fashioned way. Use your finger and turn to your Bible, through your Bible, or scroll down, or however you do it. John chapter 3, verses 22 to 30. After these things came Jesus and his disciples into the land of Judea, and there he tarried with them and was baptized. And after these things means after he spoke to Nicodemus, after that great cliff of John 3:16, the revelation of John 17 and onwards underneath it that we saw last week that is sometimes missed. So after all these things that he's explained, Jesus came with his disciples into the land of Judea. And there he tarried with them and baptized. And John also was baptizing in Aenon near to Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. For John was not yet cast into prison. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. John answered and said, A man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. Ye yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This my joy therefore is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must increase. May the Lord bless the reading and the message. Amen. We see a couple of very interesting things in these verses. We see the baptizers. There's two of them, two people baptizing at the same time, Jesus and John the Baptist. We also see that there was a question raised by John's disciples. And we see John's answer to that. And then we see the example that John gives to explain the whole purpose behind what they're doing. So first of all, the baptizers, we see there that John and Jesus, these are concurrent ministries, okay, of Jesus and John. Sometimes we get the idea that John finished his mission and then Jesus carried on. We don't seem to realize for a short period of time they were actually working together. We see that in verse 22. After these things came Jesus and his disciples into the land of Judea, where he tarried with them and baptized. So we've already seen what we're after these things. Now he's with his disciples. We know he had 12 apostles and at one time. Remember last week we saw that he had it was 15 altogether, but we know that he had 12 all at once. So we don't know if all 12 of them are here with him. It just says his disciples, because remember in Mark chapter 3 and Luke chapter 6, it just mentions his apostles when he appointed his apostles. So at this time period, he's not yet appointed any apostles. He only has disciples. And we know, as we've gone through John, that he's got John, the guy that wrote the gospel, Saint John. He has Andrew, he has Peter, he has Philip, and he has Nathaniel. So he has these six guys, 5 guys with him at this point. We know that because they're his disciples in this chapter. Now the land of Judea, there's no specific area mentioned, just the land of Judea. That's where if you get the coast of the Mediterranean, get the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan and the Dead Sea, and you've got Jerusalem about here, and you've got all this space, all this land is the land of Judea. So there's a big area. Then you have Samaria, and then you have Galilee, and you have, I think it's Perea off to the side. But he's in Judea, and no specific area, various locations, even from village to village, town to town, going about to witness. We know that later on in chapter 4, he leaves for Samaria and he carries on. Now, why is he tarrying? He's tarrying there. He's taking his time. He's being patient because he wants to go and find those that need to be saved, those that need to be baptized. Plus, he has five potential apostles and an unknown number of disciples that he needs to train up in the way that he is to go. So he stayed to work with and to teach his disciples to make and baptize believers. That's a very interesting point, so I'll hold on to that one. Now John, in verse 23, says, "And John also was baptizing in Aenon near to Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized." Now Aenon is near Salim. So we go back to our map of the Sea of Galilee and the Jordan and the Dead Sea. We've got Jerusalem about here. Then almost halfway up next on the northeast, southwest side, because I'm doing this backwards, on the west side of the Jordan, you have Aenon and Salim. Okay. Now they're not in Judea and they're not in Galilee. They're actually in a place called, if I can find it in my notes, because I had to write it down. They're in a place called something else, which doesn't matter at the minute. Decapolis, that's the area. They're in Decapolis. Just a little geography lesson. Halfway between Jerusalem and the Sea of Galilee. So we can see that there's quite a bit of distance between them. John really hasn't moved very far from where he was baptizing at the start, just a bit further up. So there's quite a space between them. Now there's much water there. Now this could mean he's baptizing in the Jordan again, or he's baptizing in some pools, some lakes, some baptismal pools. Now this, along with the emphasis on the word baptisma, indicates he was doing this by immersion. This is where we get the idea from. This is where we get the teaching that we're to baptize by immersion, as in the burying of the body and the raising to new life. The Jews came to John. I want you to remember this. They came out to John. Now Jesus went out to seek people, but people came to John. There's a slight difference in these two ministries that's very important for us as we go along. They came out to him. We see that in Matthew chapter 3. If you turn with your fingers to Matthew chapter 3 in your Bibles, and verses 5 and 6. It says there, "Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the regions round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in the Jordan, confessing their sins." So they did that the first time. Now they're doing it the second time. They're going out to John to be baptized. Whereas we see Jesus going out to people, especially when Luke tells us in Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19, verse 10. It says there, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which is lost." Now this is an important teaching. Jews went to John to be baptized. That was a Jewish baptism for purification. Jesus came, the whole reason he came from heaven, left the glories of heaven, came to earth, was to seek and to save that which is lost. And that which is lost are sinners, people who do not believe in Christ, people who have not accepted him as their saviour. Those are the people Jesus came to seek and to save. And not just the once, he's doing it now. He's constantly doing it through his saints, through those that go out and evangelize, give out the gospel message, drag people to church to watch their children sing, and listen to the preacher afterwards. This is a very important thing that Jesus is doing. He's still going out there to witness, to reach people, and to give them eternal life. Now, we have an after verse here, John chapter 3, verse 24. It almost seems like it's just been put in there, for John was not yet cast into prison. So John was baptizing, but he wasn't cast into prison yet. That's something that's yet to happen. Does anybody remember why John was cast into prison? Ask you this question. Anybody? He was cast into prison because he told Herod that he couldn't marry his brother's wife. And Herod didn't like that, so he cast him into prison. But he was too scared of the people who saw John as a prophet to actually kill him. Until something else terrible happened and he got beheaded. So we see all of this happening. Now, the other interesting thing to realise that we get from this verse and from verses like it, especially in Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 to 12, that's talking about John the Baptist being put into prison, that all of this happened. John the Baptist was born in 5 AD, and he died about 28 AD. So John was only about 26 to 27 years old when he was beheaded. He wasn't an old man like you see in some of the pictures. He was a young man. Our teens, our young adults, these are the people that drive the church forward. These are the people that revitalize, and they go out and they witness and they tell people the gospel message. And we see the example throughout scripture that these people were not that old. You know, not like in the Old Testament. Then there's a question asked of John in verse 25. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. Now, John's disciples, two of which went off to be with Jesus when John said, "Behold the Lamb of God." Remember, that was John the Apostle and Andrew, his brother, and Andrew. They went off to follow Jesus, but the rest of his disciples, John's disciples, stayed with him, which seems rather odd. But they stayed with him. Now the Jews are asking John and his disciples about purifying. Why? They're still asking that same question. John, why are you baptizing? Because this is not the purification of the Jews. This is not how Jews purify themselves. They purified their utensils by washing them in water. They purified themselves before they went into homes, temples, by washing their feet, washing their hands. But baptizing somebody, this was never heard of before. This was something completely new. So these Jews were being baptized and repenting of their sins, looking forward to the Messiah being crucified for our sins. This was something that was a forward-looking event. When we're baptized now, it's in remembrance of something that has already happened, that Christ has saved us, and we're being baptized to show that we believe in what has already happened. John's baptism of purification was for the Jews only. That's very important for us to understand, because this is why we have the two concurrent ministry. John is still baptizing the Jews. Jesus is baptizing anybody. Because look at what he says. Look at what he said in the next verse. And they came unto John and said unto him, "Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him." So they came to John, and they said unto, after talking to the Jews and discussing with the Jews, John's disciples came to him, and they said, "Rabbi," they'd been very polite, calling him master. He said, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, he that was with thee, who was this? This was Jesus, the Messiah. Surely John's disciples should have realized this. And they're just saying, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness. Now, if John the Baptist bore witness that this guy was the Lamb of God, why are John's disciples not taking this seriously? And even now they're saying, to whom you bear witness. They say, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. Notice that difference in the two baptisms. The people came to John to be baptized. Jesus went to people and led them and baptized them. Remember, he went to the woman in Samaria. He went to Jairus. He went to the centurion. You know, he moved around and he visited people and he went to where these people were. Remember what the Jews always said about him. How can you go and eat in a prostitute's house or a publican's house or have dealings with these people? Why? Because those are the people he went to witness to, that he went to save, that he went to seek, and he went to bring back into the fold. Those are the people we should be witnessing to. You know, we should not look down upon anybody. It doesn't matter what they've done in their life, no matter what they're doing in their life, no matter how they're behaving, they still need to hear the witness, the gospel message. We need to go to them and bring that message to them. Then in verse 27, he answers the question. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it is given him from heaven. So they asked about this purifying. Are we purified by going through this baptism? John says you can't receive anything unless you receive it from God in heaven. You may go through these waters and think you're baptized and that you're purified, but unless you genuinely accept what God has said, that the Messiah has come and that he is the Lamb of God, then it's pointless, because you can only receive things from heaven. Everything we have and we own, our health, our wealth, our prospects, everything we receive from God in heaven. Even sinners receive things from God in heaven. They receive everything because God created everything. There's two sorts of grace that God has. They're called common grace and they're called special grace. The common grace is what he gives to everybody. It rains, the sun shines, the soft breeze blows through the trees, the birds sing. You get a wage packet. You have a home, food, warmth. That's God's general grace to everybody. And then there's the special grace. When you believe that Jesus Christ is the Messiah and you receive the Holy Spirit. And then God gives you special grace because now you're a child of God. You're a brother or sister in Christ, of Christ. And sit on the right hand of God with him. Which completely blows my mind how that can happen. But that's what it says. It says, he that was with thee, he says, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. Then he says in verse 28, he says, ye yourselves, why weren't you listening, he says. You yourselves bear me witness. You were there, you witnessed what I said, you witnessed the Messiah being baptized, you witnessed that I said this is the Lamb of God, yet you didn't hear it. He said, I am not the Christ. I cannot purify you, he's saying. This is John the Baptist. You know, I cannot save you. The Pope cannot save you. Elder Garside, bless his cotton socks, cannot save you. Nobody, no man on the face of this earth can say to you, you are saved. All we can do is give you the gospel message. And then it's up to you to decide whether you want to ignore it and go to hell or believe it and go to glory, to go to heaven. Whether Jesus is your Messiah, your Saviour, or whether he isn't. That is up to you. All we can do is give you that gospel message. That's a heavy weight for us to bear because we want you to be saved. Remember what John 3:16 says? For God so loved the world. That's not for God so loved Christians or for God so loved the church. It's God loved the world. And the reason, and because he loved the world, he sent his son who we're witnessing of. That's the message. That's Jesus still going out to seek and to save that which was lost. Look at verse 29. Now, this is a really big picture that John is giving us in one single verse. And I'm going to describe the Jewish wedding ceremonies to you. So then when you read this, you'll understand what's going on. And when a Jewish man proposed to a Jewish woman, and she said yes, that was as good as being married. But then they would separate. She would go off to her family's home, and they would celebrate, and they would have a party, and everybody in the town would come along and bring gifts and drink wine and have a merry old time. And then the groom would be doing the same with his family. And he would also be doing this in the house that he is preparing for his bride, their new home. And they'd be having parties and celebrating and so on. And then the best man, this is where we get the idea of the best man at weddings. The best man, his friend, will be at the bride celebration. Not with the groom, he will be at the bride celebration because he's standing at the door waiting for the groom to come and fetch his bride. As soon as he hears the fanfare, the trumpets, or whatever else, the men cheering, bringing the bride to the bridegroom, he goes in and he tells the bridegroom, your bridegroom is here. He's coming to fetch you. This is the picture that he's using, and it's used throughout the New Testament. It's something to remember. He says, he that hath the bride, the church, is the bridegroom, Jesus Christ. He's the one who has proposed. This is what he's doing when he's gone out to seek to save those which are lost. He's gone out to seek his bride. He says, but the friend of the bridegroom, that's John the Baptist in this instance, and Christians in general, because we witness of the Messiah. But the friend of the bridegroom, the best man, which standeth and heareth him. That's what we're listening for. We're listening for the Messiah to come in the second time. He standeth and heareth him, and then he rejoices greatly. The bridegroom is coming. The Messiah is returning. He's coming back to claim the church, his bride, to take his bride, the church, to that place that he's prepared for us. Remember what he said, I go to prepare a place for you because you're my bride, that's where I'm going to take you, to live with me forever in eternal glories. He that standeth heareth him rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. John the Baptist then says, this, hearing the bridegroom's voice, this is my joy. He says, this is the whole reason I am joyous, I am happy, because I can hear the Messiah calling. Is this something that is in our lives? Are we joyous because we can hear the Messiah? Because we can read his word, because we can pray to him, because we can have an interaction and a relationship with him. Is it something that brings joy to our hearts? Ask yourself that question. This my joy, says, therefore is fulfilled. Everything I've done, everything I wanted, everything I've ministered for is to hear the bridegroom coming. John is saying, that's my job done. That's the best man's job done. He goes in, he tells the bride, tells the church, and he steps back and allows the bridegroom to go in and take that which is his. That was John the Baptist's job. And that is our job today, to go out and to do that. And then he says in verse 30, and verse 30 is a beautiful verse that we must all remember, must all realise and understand that this applies to us as Christians. Okay? This applies especially to pastors or missionaries or people who go out and witness or have any ministry that they think may elevate them above others. It doesn't. Look at this verse. This is John the Baptist saying this. He says, he must increase, but I must decrease. Jesus Christ must increase. The knowledge of him, the understanding of him, the witness of him must increase in this earth. That's what he's saying. But the knowledge of me, John the Baptist, or the knowledge of me, the Christian, the witness, must decrease. I'm not important. I've delivered the message. The person has understood it, has accepted Christ. Now I step back and allow that glorious relationship between the believer and Christ. He says, he must increase, but I must decrease. So there's two questions we need to ask ourselves this morning. Do we have the joy of hearing God's word, God's voice? Is it something that brings joy to our hearts? If it isn't, then there's something wrong. There's something you need to put right. You need to get on your knees. You need to repent. You need to turn to the Messiah. You need to turn to the Saviour and be saved and to accept him. Then you will have that joy, that peace, that grace, that understanding that God gives you. And then the second question we must ask, are we decreasing when we witness to people, or are we standing in the way? Do we put plans and steps and stumbling blocks in the way of salvation? You know, you go to some churches and to get saved or confirmed or whatever, you have to do a confirmation class, or you have to do this class, you have to do the 12-step method, or you have to do a pre-baptismal lesson, or have a really big talk to your pastor to make sure that you are saved. And it goes on, and we put in obstacles in the way of these people, because it's between the person and between God. So I'm asking you this morning, if you're listening here, if you're listening on the video, because I know there's a lot of people, Vijay and a lot of other people in India are watching this, that if there is somebody who is not saved, they need to repent and believe in the Son of God. Then that joy will come to you. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Just a short message this morning, because the temperature is increasing and it's getting hotter. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your blessed word. We thank you, Lord, for your teachings. We thank you, Lord, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died upon the cross for our sins. Father, we ask that if there is anybody who does not know you, that they would repent, Lord. They would turn to you, and with joy in their hearts, they would accept you as their Saviour. Father, we ask that the saints gathered here today would understand your word, would go out and teach it to others, Lord, would spread the gospel message far and wide to their relatives, Lord, to their friends, to their acquaintances, even to those that don't like them, Lord, to their enemies. Because all these people need to hear of your word. They need to hear your gospel message. Father, we ask this in your wonderful and your blessed and your holy name. Amen. 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 And we have one final song, I think. I was told that Joe had one ready for me. Whether Joe was told that. I don't mean to put you on the spot there, Joe. You seem to be... All the women have put you on the spot there. Joe's like, I don't know. Joe's developed that selective hearing that men have over the years.
I've only got this book to choose from.
You tell me one that I can... You pick one, and I'll tell you if I can sing it.
Ascribe Greatness.
No.
You don't know it?
No. Hang on. Talk amongst yourselves for a second.
Oh, come all ye faithful. Do you want that one again? You did it last week. That's the deer.
Yes, let's do that one. What number is that? Is it the same as in this book?
No.
No, okay. Let me find it then. You can tell how much organisation goes into these services, can't you? Hang on. Okay. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. I've got the wrong tune. Sorry, there's two in here. I don't know why, I've never noticed that before. 27, thank you, Brian. Okay, Joe. The deer pants worship you. You're my friend and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than anything. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you my spirit heal. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Amen. We got there finally. Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Joe, for putting up with an appalling song leader. I do apologise. One other thing for everybody to take note, especially if you're watching on the video, is that from next week, because we can come to church and we can sing and we can do things normally, only the message will be recorded. Okay, so people won't get to see the farce that happens at the start of church, okay? So only the message will be recorded. Bookend, would you close us in prayer, please, John?
Once again, Heavenly Father, we've fed by your word, Heavenly Father. From the children this morning, Heavenly Father, singing your words, Heavenly Father. And from the end, Heavenly Father, singing your words. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, like a sandwich, Heavenly Father. There's a bit in the middle, Lord, which is your word, Heavenly Father. And like Pastor said, we're all here for a season. From the young to the elderly, Heavenly Father, and the sandwich in the middle, we pray, Lord, that as we go out into this world, Lord, we take the middle sandwich, Heavenly Father. There's a world out there hungry, Heavenly Father, but not physical food, but spiritual food. Give us the grace, Heavenly Father. Give us the wisdom. Give us the courage.